morning, everyone. We serve a great God. The Bible says, great is our Lord and mighty in power. His understanding is infinite. So we're going to give him glory this morning. Thank you. You.
Thank you. Worship continues in your giving. Amen. Yes. It's all right. I'm going to plug the giving this morning because God is faithful.
Yes, he sure is. Come on.
And just to give you a little snippet, I was unemployed for 2 years.
Yes.
And God made sure every bill got paid and even put a family room on my house. I'm telling you something today. If you want this, trust God.
Yes, come on, come on.
It doesn't matter how much you put in the offering plate, if you would just trust God with that little bit,
trust God.
And he sees that you're faithful. Hallelujah. God will bless you. Trust me. Try it. And see if he won't do it. Glory to God. Giving is very important because, you know, the church has needs and we want to keep God's work moving. Amen. And we are thankful for all those that are giving. But I encourage you today, if you think you can't afford not to give, turn that statement around. You can't afford not to give. Turn that statement around. Amen. Because my Bible tells me if you don't, you know, pay those tithes, you can find ways to snip holes in your pockets and the money just gets away from you. But I found out that when you are obedient to God and you do what God says, your pockets will never be empty. My pockets have never been empty since I started paying tithes. You hear me? My bank account's never been on zero.
Always takes care.
He always finds a way. Amen?
Sure.
Let us pray. Father, I thank you right now for your anointing, God, for your mercy, for your grace. Thank you for your faithfulness, God. I ask that you'll bless everyone right now in this offering time. 100-fold, God. You meet every need. Every need, God, we pray in Jesus' name. Let the church sing, amen.
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 Amen. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Bless the Lord. Praise God this morning. I don't know about you, but I feel like we already had church today. We can just go ahead and have the benediction and go home. Amen. Praise the Lord this morning.
Yes, thank you, Jesus.
Let the King be lifted.
Yes.
That's what we came to do today. You know, that's I don't know what you came to do, but I came to praise the Lord this morning. Amen. I came to bless his name, to lift him up, to magnify the Lord today. I want you to get your Bibles and go with me to Psalm 86 this morning. I want to talk to you about some things that we've been talking about over the last several weeks, which is, one is the heart, the mind, the heart. The center of our being, amen? You know, the Bible has a lot to say about our hearts this morning. Over 800 verses of scripture refer to the heart. 800 scriptures. There's a scripture there. You can get a couple scriptures each day for your heart, amen? 134 scriptures, 134 verses in the Psalms alone refer to the heart. 86 in the Proverbs, 61 times in the Gospel do they refer to the heart. The Bible uses the word heart to refer to the ruling center of the whole person. The Bible tells us that out of it spring all our desires, all the issues of our life, all the concerns, all the cares, everything that we focus on, we think about, we are, comes out of the heart this morning. Amen?
Amen.
Our intellect, our character, our seat of the will, our mind, These are all the all terms that the Bible refers back to the heart. And according to the Bible, the heart is the center not only of our spiritual activity, but also all the operations of our human life. I think without our hearts, we wouldn't have blood pumping this morning, amen?
Amen.
We might be not here, so praise God we're here this morning, amen? Amen. And if you're here this morning or if you're live on Facebook, praise God this morning. You ought to wave and say, thank you, Lord,
thank
for
you
my
Lord.
Heart today, amen?
Hallelujah.
Thank you for the heart. The Bible says much about the heart. There are bad hearts, proud hearts, 2 Chronicles 25:19, Proverbs 21:4, idolatrous hearts, Ezekiel 14. There are turned away hearts from God. People who have turned their hearts away from God, backslidden, gone away. Isaiah 29:13. There's the hardened heart. We don't want that this morning, amen? 2 Chronicles 36:13. There's the embittered heart, Psalm 73:21. The stubborn heart in Psalms 81:12. There's the erroneous heart in Psalms 95:10. The deceitful heart, Jeremiah 17. We're going to look at that one in a minute. The backslider in heart, Proverbs 14:14. There are good hearts. The Bible says in Psalm 51:10, created me a clean heart. Amen. Deuteronomy 5:29 says that we need to have a heart to fear the Lord. Psalms 51:17 says that we need to have a broken and contrite heart when we come before the Lord. Amen. 2 Kings 22:19 refers to the tender heart. Psalms 57:10 talks about the steadfast heart. Proverbs 15 refers to the joyful or glad heart. Proverbs 14:30 talks about the tranquil heart. Psalms 32:11 talks about the upright heart. And 1 Samuel 13:14, we found that David had a heart that was after God's own heart. Amen?
Yes. Amen.
The heart. And here in Psalm 86, we're going to start at verse 6 this morning. And picking up the Bible says, give ear, O Lord, to my prayer, and attend to the voice of my supplications. In the day of my trouble, I will call upon you, for you will answer me. Among the gods, there is none like you, O Lord, nor are there any works like your works. All nations whom you've made shall come and worship before you, O Lord, and shall glorify your name. For you are great and do wondrous things. You alone are God. Teach me your way, O Lord, and I will walk in your truth. Unite my heart to fear your name. I will praise you, O Lord, my God, with all my heart, and I will glorify your name forevermore. I'm going to stop right there. Give ear, O Lord. That was David's prayer. He's praying to God. He's calling on God. But if you notice something, if you go back to that 11th verse, that's the center of what his prayer is all about. He says, teach me your way, O Lord, because I don't know which way to go. Amen?
Amen.
And then he says something very unique there that we got to pay attention to this morning, because he says, unite my heart to fear your name. A lot of different versions put it this way. The Message Bible says, train me, God, to walk straight. Then I'll follow your true path. Put me together, one heart and mind. Then undivided, I'll worship in joyful fear. Other translators put it, make my heart focused only on honoring your name. And then we have this paraphrase from the ERV Bible. Help me make worshiping your name the most important thing in my life. I like how Eugene Peterson puts it in the Message Bible. Put me together, one heart and mind. Then undivided, I'll worship in joyful fear. I need to be put together sometimes. How about you?
Amen.
You know, David talks about these things in here. What David points out in this psalm is something that we all know about the divided heart. Because our heart, you know, it's hard. David said, there's a lot of wonderful things in this world, Lord, that distract me from you. I'm pulled this way and I'm pulled that way. There's the appeal of this and the appeal of that. And I want this and I want that, but I want you too, Jesus. I want to be with you. Your brain may rule your head, but your heart rules your emotions. Your emotions are to life what pigment is to paint. Our emotions are attached to us. So how you feel today, how you feel it here, that's how you act. Amen? That's how we come out. Praise God. The divided heart describes a person who is in love with two people. One of whom is going to be certain to sustain some pain and some suffering, some loss. Amen? Picture this, that you're a guy wanting to court a woman, and you say, hey girl, I'd like to marry you, but I'm going to go out there and date those other 50 girls out there too. That's not going to fly too well, is it? Jeremiah 17 reminds us that the Lord searches the hearts. Amen? He says, I test the mind even to give every man according to his ways. You see, the believer may have in his heart, he may have a heart to serve God. I have a heart to serve God this morning. I want to serve him with everything I have. Amen? I want to be everything that God's called me to be. But I'm distracted. I'm distracted by the world. I'm pulled by my job, Pastor Ty. I'm pulled by the influences, politicians and politics, and the problems that are happening all around the globe this morning. I'm pulled by these things. And, you know, while a believer may have in his heart to serve God, if he has a heart for the trinkets of the world, in practice, he'll often get caught up in worldly activities. He's given a place in his heart to the Lord, but he hasn't given his whole heart to the Lord this morning. Amen? He feels drawn by the Spirit after the things of God, but he also feels drawn by his flesh after the things of the world. How many of you can relate to that this morning? You know, you'll find him in church on Sunday, but the rest of the week, you'll find that he has very little to do with God. In this psalm, David declares, the first thing I see here is he says, God, I need to go deep. Verse 6, you see it there? Give ear, O Lord, to my prayer. Attend unto the voice of my supplications. God, I'm crying out to you. I need to go deep this morning. Amen? Amen. You see, because when our hearts are divided, we need to get deep in with Christ this morning. Amen? We need to go deeper. Because see, when I'm in the deep water, I got no place else to run to. Jonah had to go deep into the belly of the well before his heart turned back to God. You see what I'm saying this morning? God wants our hearts this morning. Divided hearts. There are three things that stand out about the divided heart. A divided heart will not stick around. Yep. Divided heart's not going to stick around. You can't count on them. You can't depend on them. There's no way that you can trust a divided heart. They're there 1 minute and gone the next. First Chronicles is a wonderful passage of scripture. First Chronicles 12, you don't have to turn there. I'm going to turn there for you this morning. But it talks about a team of people who rallied to David's aid back when David was in Ziklag and he was going down to Hebron and he was on the run from Saul. Saul was chasing him. But you know, the people of Israel, a lot of them had recognized that David was going to be king. And the Bible talks about that some of these folks had decided that they were going to rally around David. And I like how the Bible puts it in verse 33, 1 Chronicles 12, 33. It says, of Zebulun there were 50,000 who went out to battle, expert in war with all weapons of war, stout-hearted men who could keep the ranks. These are men who would, they didn't have a double-minded heart. They had a heart to serve, a heart for David. And they said, David, we commit ourselves 100% to you. We are all in with you, David. Louis Jordan used to have a song out some years back, is you or is you not my baby? Yeah, is you or is you not my baby? Because the way you've been acting lately, I'm in doubt. You know? God might be saying that to some of us this morning, amen? Is you is or is you not my baby? Because the way you've been acting lately, I'm in doubt. True strength never lies in numbers. David didn't have to depend on the 50,000 men. What he did have to trust in was in God. Amen? Yes. These were men who had a heart to serve the Lord. Second thing I see about a divided heart is it's not committed to winning. Any coach of a good team will tell you, I don't need a half-hearted player. He wants somebody who's 100% committed, somebody who's focused on winning, not on just getting in there and playing the game. Oh, yeah, it's just going to be a great game, coach. Why don't, you know, we just go out and have fun this afternoon. No, the coach wants to win.
That's right.
You run this race to win, amen? Come on. Paul said we're going to race this time, this afternoon, this morning to win, amen?
Amen.
And we've got to be focused on winning. Come on. Not just being in the game. I don't want to just Be in the world. Be a part of the church. Take up a seat. I want to move mountains. I want to shake trees. I want to see demons tremble. I want to see the devil run. That's what I want to see. But you know what it takes? Can't take a double heart. Can't take a double heart. You got to be committed to winning. James says a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Let not that man think he'll get anything from the Lord, he says. You know, we got to make up our minds. Either you're in or you're not. And that's why coaches will say, winning isn't everything. It's the only thing. It's the only thing this morning. Amen?
Amen.
Our true commitment to the Lord has got to never be in just our words or our intentions. I don't just intend to be a good Christian. I'm going to serve God with everything I have. Amen? That's what David's talking about in this psalm. He says, give ear to my prayer, O Lord. I'm trying to go deep with you. I'm trying to get in here with you, God. He says, listen. He says, in the day of trouble, I call upon you and you answer me. I've always depended upon you, God. You're always there for me. But I need something more. I'm still distracted. Hosea 10 says that the Lord is not pleased when he's just another option. Listen to what the scripture says. It says, Israel is an empty vine. He bringeth forth fruit unto himself. According to the multitude of his fruit, he hath increased the altars. According to the goodness of his land, they have made goodly images. Their heart is divided. Now shall they be found faulty. He shall break down their altars. He shall spoil their images. God does not like a double heart. Amen? And you know what? Let not that man suppose he'll receive anything from the Lord. The reason some of us don't have all that we need or all that we want right now is because our hearts go two ways. The third thing about the divided heart is unsure of who he or she is. People with divided hearts do not have a clear idea of where they stand with the Lord. Therefore, whenever it feels convenient or advantageous, they put on the Christian shield and they sing the choruses of the songs. They're spiritual chameleons. They suffer from a divided heart. And when the dark days and the trials come, they got nothing to stand on, no well to deep in, to dig into, nothing to drink from. And so they wonder why they get fearful and anxious and discouraged and fall apart. And it's because your heart is not single. The Lord addressed these kind of middle-of-the-road people in the church of Laodicea in Revelation chapter 3. Remember what he says? He says, listen to what he said. He said, unto the angel of the church in Laodiceans, write these things with, saith the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would thou wert cold or hot. So then because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. He says, it's better that you be one way or the other. Better to be either in or out. You know, a lot of people are like that. They're like that angel that we see in the book of Revelation, one foot on the land and one foot on the water. Mm-hmm. You know, we're trying to walk with Jesus, but we're trying to stay in the world. And it doesn't work, church. David writes in verse 8, among the gods there is none like you, O Lord. And you know, this morning I'm going to tell you something, church. We need to understand that there's a lot of little gods in this world today. There's a lot of little gods. And then, yeah, you said, well, Pastor, yeah, what do you mean? There's a lot of idols that we still worship today. We have an obsession today for power. We have an obsession today for pleasure. And we have an obsession today for the intellect. We're always learning but never coming to the knowledge of the truth. Some people are always, they've been lifelong students, forever in college, never learning what they should be learning. Some people still keep taking the same lessons over and over and over again, making the same mistakes. Over and over and over again. Why? Never learning the truth. They have an obsession for learning. Obsession for going through these things. You say, what is David? In David's day, they were a little bit more down to earth. See, they recognized their gods. What they did was they oftentimes took these, and I put it up here, little shrines. They built little shrines in their homes. And they have these little shrines where they put their little gods up and they put their little tinkets up and they have flowers. They burn incense and they make their prayers and supplication to their gods. And that's how they did it. There was in David's day, there was the gods of Baal. Baal is the pleasure and fertility god. He was believed to enable the earth to produce crops and to produce people to produce children. And so people would pray. They would actually pray. They would set up these little altars. They would sit there and they pray, "Oh, Baal, bless my crops this year. Oh, mighty God, Baal, come on down and do this and do that." And that's how they prayed. And you know what? For some of them, it seemed to work. For some, because that's what the scriptures tell us, doesn't it? They seemed to work. You know, Baal was so popular that he actually had his own denomination. They had denominations of Baal. Depending on what region you were in, there was a denominational Baal, Baalism. You know? There was like the First Baptist Baals and the Second Baptist Baals, the Third Baptist Baals, you know, and the Assembly of Baals over there. Then they worshiped and served Mammon. And Mammon is the love of money or power or position or prestige. We have people like that today. They're called politicians. That's what we call them, politicians. They love power. They love to rule over you. They want to control you. There's nothing new about this. Nothing new. Then there was Molech. And he was the most repulsive of the pagan gods. Because he called for the ritual sacrifice of your children. And we have that called abortion today. And David said, "There's no pagan God like you, O Lord. None can do what you do." A good lesson about that is found in 1 Samuel chapter 5. I don't know if I put it up there or not. But it talks about Dagon. Remember the little god Dagon? That's a good story. You should go back and read that sometime. The ark of the Lord came in. They put it in the building that night. And then all of a sudden they set their little god up, Dagon, in there with it. And the next morning they came in and Dagon was knocked over. And so they said, "Oh, what happened to Dagon?" So they put Dagon back up, they stood it back up, they left him in there with the ark. The next morning they came down, Dagon wasn't just knocked over. His arms were cut off, his head was cut off, and his legs were cut off. They said, "Uh-oh, get that ark out of here.
Right, right.
There is no God like God." David said, "There's no pagan God like you, Lord." And he said, "You know what? You know, Lord, even though people are worshiping all these other gods, I want to focus on you. I don't want to be divided. I'm not going to serve Baal and you. I'm not going to serve Astra and you. I'm going to serve God. I'm serving the Lord." And you say, many of us would say today, "Well, Pastor, I'm not an idolater. I don't have an altar in my house." Well, do we have a TV? How much time do we spend in front of it? Or how about the video games? And I'm not beating you up on playing video games. I'm just telling you, there has to be a balance. You know, because our obsession for pleasure, our thrill of the rise, and we want to go to Disneyland, and we want to have everything now, and I want the flesh to feel thrilled. I love the flesh being thrilled. Why? Because the flesh feels good. But it's not what the Spirit wants. So how do we get an undivided heart? What does it look like? Because that's what we want to have this morning when we leave here today. Amen?
Amen.
I want to have a heart that's set on God. Amen. And we see that when he prayed the prayer, "Give ear," we need to, first of all, see that we need to pray for this kind of heart. So there's three things I want to show you about an undivided heart, what it looks like. And the first thing is this, that an undivided heart has spiritual tunnel vision. Now Wikipedia writes that tunnel vision is the loss of peripheral vision with retention of central vision, resulting in constricted circular tunnel-like field of vision. In other words, I can't see Sister Denise right now, and I can't see, well, if I turn a little bit this way, I can't see either her or Sister Tony. All I can see Sister Darlene back here, and I can see my brother up here in front of me, Angel. All right? That's all I can see. I might be able to squeeze in some Heather and get a little Todd over there, but that's about it. All right? I got tunnel vision. All right? So the first thing we got to understand is God's calling us to have some spiritual tunnel vision this morning.
Amen.
In Matthew 5, verse 8, Jesus said, "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God." Now, the Greek word for the word pure is the word katharos, which describes a heart that is pure in motive and which exhibits single-mindedness, undivided devotion, and spiritual integrity. In other words, it's like Paul when he says, "This one thing I do," in Philippians 3. It's a heart that is, a pure heart is a heart that has a single focus. That's what it's saying here.
Yeah.
Catharsis, while we have a pure focus, we want to have a pure heart, we want to be morally pure, and we want to be free from sensuality. The idea of catharsis is that it is our attitude, our integrity, and our single-mindedness, as opposed to duplicity of heart. Thus, we might paraphrase this in Jesus' words, I desire a heart that is unmixed in its devotion or motivation towards me. God wants a heart that's pure this morning, amen? As opposed to a heart that's double. Matthew 6 gives a good picture of a heart that's double. Let me go over there for a minute because I'm going to turn there. You don't have to turn there. But Matthew 6, 21, the Bible says this, for where your treasure is, there your heart is also. And then he goes on to say, the lamp of the body is the eye. If therefore your eye is good, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eye be bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. If therefore the light that is in you is darkness, how great is that darkness? No one can serve two masters. They either hate the one, love the other, or else be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. Jesus says a double-minded heart, a double-vision heart, can't serve God. You know, we might think that we're serving God. We might even be in the church today. We might even be a minister today. Oh, I'm preaching this morning. I know it. Because I was preaching myself when I was writing this. Amen. We might even be the pastor.
Come on.
You know? But if our heart ain't single, it ain't right. God needs a single. He needs a heart that's focused. Amen.
Amen.
The second thing about this heart that's undivided is a heart that's spiritually united. Ezekiel, let me turn over there I don't have to turn. I got it on my paper here. Ezekiel chapter 11, verse 19 to 20 reads this. It says, and I shall give them one heart and shall put a new spirit within them. And I shall take the heart of stone out of their flesh and give them a heart of flesh. Listen to that. He says, I will give them one heart. It's a heart that's what? One heart. It's united. It's obedient. Look, he says, and I shall put a new spirit within them. And I shall take the heart of stone out of their flesh. And give them a heart of flesh.
Amen.
The description of one heart, an undivided heart. The mirror. This is the miracle that we get it at conversion. When we come to Christ, this, you know, if you're in Christ Jesus, you got a new heart. If any man be in Christ, the Bible says he's a new creature. Amen. Amen. Old things have passed away. All things are made brand new. So guess what? You got a new brain this morning. You got a new heart this morning. You got new feet. You got some new hands. New everything. Amen.
Amen.
We need to run with those things. Amen. Praise God. I like how Ezekiel 36, he goes on to say this. He says, moreover, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you, and I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh, and I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you will be careful to observe my ordinances. Ezekiel 36, 26 and 27. Now that's the promise of God's word. God says, I'm going to give you a new heart when you come to me. When we came to Christ, we had a new heart. Amen. He gave us a new heart. Now, that heart, we have to mold and shape towards him. Amen? We have to train that heart how to follow him. Amen?
Amen.
You know, because here's the thing. If I live in this world, I still see this world. And all these things are doing what? Distracting me. So I need to say, I will grit my teeth this morning, and I will follow God with an undivided heart. I want that new heart this morning. Amen?
Yeah.
The third thing we had to have is spiritual vertical vision. Everybody say vertical vision.
Vertical vision.
Okay, you got tunnel vision, you got spiritually united, and now you got vertical vision. Where's vertical?
Up and down.
Where's vertical? Somebody point vertically. Up, right?
Yep.
Psalm 42, verse 6. Psalm 42, let me turn over there for a minute. I didn't put that scripture on my notes, but I got the reference there. I want to share that one with you this morning. Listen to what David says, 42 verse 6. And he says this, oh my God, my soul is cast down within me. Therefore, I will remember you from the land of the Jordan and from the heights of Hermon and from the hill Mizar. I got to back up. This is too good. I love this song. I just got to back up a little bit. We could park here the rest of the day, but we can't. We don't have time. And I'll start at verse 5. Why are you cast down, O my soul, and why are you disquieted within me? Hope in God, he says.
Yes.
For I shall yet praise him for the help of his countenance. And then he says in verse 6, oh my God, my soul is cast down within me. And then he goes on to say, and he says, therefore I will remember you. He says, look, David says, look, in my heaviness, in the heaviness I'm carrying this morning, I'm going to remember God. I look up. Oh, I look up. What happened? I looked up. In other words, I'm not focused on this. I'm not horizontally looking around to see who can help me with this and who can fix that and how I can get through this. I look up and I look to the problem solver this morning, amen? Yes. The one who can fix everything, amen? Yes. I'm not going to be looking at the problem. I'm not going to be looking at what's this stuff like because I got this tunnel vision and then I'm looking up. And I'm going to keep my eyes fixed on him this morning. Because he's the only one can fix the stuff that's broken this morning. Amen? Amen. I remember thee, David says. I remember thee. This is an act of faith. I remember God. When Jonah was in the well, he said, I remember. He called on the Lord. It wasn't until he called on the Lord he got delivered. You see, when do you remember God this morning? If you remember who your Lord is, it doesn't matter what you're in right now. Call out. He'll pick you up. He's ready. He's there. I remember thee, David said. He said, I literally can't see you, God, but I remember you, God. I remember you're there. I remember you're there. You know, if you want to get through despair and despondency and depression this morning, remember Jesus this morning, amen? Remember who's on the throne today. Remember his attributes, Saul said. Remember his power this morning. Remember his return is coming. Remember that Jesus holds the entire universe together in one hand. Remember who he is this morning.
Remember who he is. Thank you, Lord.
Paul said, when we set our minds on the things above, the things of the earth grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Amen. Mm-hmm. We heard this song coming in this morning. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Yes, I love that one. Look full on his wonderful face. No, don't go there, Tony. All right, I'll get started. Let's get started here. You see, Jesus came to fix us this morning.
Yes.
He's here this morning to give us a new heart. There's pretty much at the end of it right now. So I put on my notes here, trash or treasure. And the story is given of Craig Randall. And this is 1995. He drives a garbage truck in Peabody, Massachusetts. In a garbage container one day, he noticed a Wendy's soft drink cup bearing a contest sticker. And having won a chicken sandwich the week before, Randall checked it, hoping for some French fries or a soft drink. Instead, he peeled the sticker and found it was $200,000 toward the construction of a new home. Somebody had thrown it in the trash. One man's trash is somebody else's treasure. Now, why do I say that? If we're not careful, we'll spend our lives looking for treasure in trash. You'll spend your life down here looking at all this stuff, and you'll miss all that he has for you. He has real treasures for us this morning. He has a treasure of peace this morning that surpasses understanding. He has a treasure of love this morning that can never be equaled. He has treasures this morning untold that we haven't even entered into. But if we'll trust him, if we'll come to him with a single purposed heart, he'll pour all those things into us. That's why David was known as a man after God's own heart. David had a single heart for God. Everything in Psalm 86, you'll find the one thing about this psalm is everything that he quotes in there has been quoted someplace as in another psalm. That's unique about that psalm. It's like a testimony to all the other songs that he sang. It's a testimony that, God, I just want to be focused on you. I want you. You know, we look for peace and security. We look for meaning. We look for purpose and possessions and things. How many times do we go out and buy a new car and we drive it off the lot and 15 minutes later we see a better car, you know, and we're just not happy, never satisfied. Never satisfied. Discipline says I need to, duty says I ought to, and devotion, though, says I want to. Now, the Bible calls us to be disciplined. The Bible calls us to duty. But the Bible first invites us to be devoted. Mary and Martha had a situation where their brother Lazarus had died. And they were looking for the master to come. Actually, I'm getting my stories turned around, but I'll use this one anyway. because but I want you to say this, because Mary was always, she was always focused on the Lord. She always wanted to hang out with Jesus. You know, she didn't want to be busy about the housework and stuff. She just wanted to hear what the Lord had to say. Now, that's a good place to be. That's a great place to be. That's actually the better place to be, amen? That's what Jesus said. Jesus said she's chosen the better part. You know, it's better to sit here and get what we need from the Lord's feet, amen? It's better to hear the Lord's word, amen? That's why it's so important that we put the word in every day, saturating our lives with his word, because it's our food, it's our bread, it's our pancakes, it's everything. And this is why when I was preaching about the word last week, you've got to put the word in. You will not have a single heart. Your heart will never be focused if there's nothing to focus on, amen? So I'm going to give you three things here. The guidelines, I'm going to tell everybody, say guidelines. First thing I want you to do this morning is get your flags. Everybody got a flag in your hand? All right, run your flag up and decide who you serve. Oh. Whose flag are you holding this morning? Whose flag are you hoisting this morning? Mm-hmm. Because I'm holding the flag of the Lord.
Yeah.
Amen? Yeah. The United States flag is over here, but I'm holding up Jesus' flag this morning. Amen? I'm a good American, but by God, I want to be a committed Christian this morning. Amen?
Amen.
I'm serving God. I'm like Joshua. As for me and my house, this is our flag this morning. Amen?
Amen.
This is our flag. Number two, guideline number two. Everybody say close. Close that door. Mm-hmm. Close the door. Close the door that divides your loyalty. Whatever thing it is that's got you twisted right now, whatever things that got you halfway off track instead of all the way in, close the door. You say, well, Pastor, it's not that easy. You just don't see. I got this situation. I'm in this relationship. Well, no. Close the door. Listen, if it's of God, then do it right. If it's not of God, get out of it. Simple as that. If it's of God, then do it, and do it right. And if it's not, then get out of it. We play around too much. We play with God too much. And God's not to be played with this morning. He wants us to go deep. He wants us to draw into him, amen? Listen, this whole thing that's going on all around us, you see the chaos that's happening? This is not by some perhaps or circumstance. This is an orchestrated plan of God. God orchestrated COVID-19 for 2020. God orchestrated you to be at Gateway this morning. God orchestrated you folks on Facebook this morning to be there. And when you're on YouTube later on, God orchestrated you to be there. But God's orchestrating all of our footsteps. It may seem like this world is in chaos, but to God, he's just sitting back going, I got this. I got this. So close the door on all that chaos and confusion that you've been allowing in your life. That's what we need to do this morning. Amen? Amen. And the third thing is this. Guideline number three. Get busy. Get busy. You cannot and will not be of a single-minded, devoted heart to God if you're not serving him. If you're not serving him. You got to be doing something. Yeah, you can sit out there and say, okay, well, I'm a pastor, you know, and I'll come to church on Sunday. That's not enough. What are you doing Monday? You got to be praying for somebody. Tuesday. Hey, you know what? Hey, can I help you, sis? And Wednesday, hey, you know, there's a prayer meeting tonight. I got to get on the line with the prayer. Thursday, there's a Bible study. Oh, man, we got the word. You can do a home study on Monday night. See, you can take your kids, sit around. See, there's a lot of stuff we should be doing, building us up in our most holy faith. But instead, we're allowing the distractions of the world to take us away from what we should be doing. And I'm not saying that you can't watch a Laker game or anything like that, but I'm just telling you, church, where your heart's at this morning. Because where your treasure is, that's where your heart is. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. I made a couple of notes here, and this was in reference to some things that I want to just speak to this, and I want to say this. Lukewarm pastors make careless Christians. You hear what I'm saying? I pray that you have not seen me as being lukewarm. Because I am not lukewarm, church. I am 100% committed to Jesus. And if you think anything less than I've given you the wrong impression, shame on me. God forgive me this morning. But I want you to know I am 100% dedicated to serving the Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Amen? It's not the opinions of men. It's not opinions that men need. They don't need my opinion. You don't need my opinion this morning. Amen? What you need is the truth. The truth is, if you're not right with God, get right today. Simple as that. I'm not going to tell you that. I'm not going to rebuke you and tell you, oh, you should do this. No, that's not my place. You know what you're doing if you're doing it. Amen? Stop it. It's not, you need truth. You don't need theology this morning. You need God. Amen? You don't need a doctrine lesson. I don't need to teach you doctrine here. What you need is God. You need a whole heart for God. Amen?
Amen.
You don't need religion. You need Christ. Amen? Amen? You need Christ. So I want you to get off your seats this morning. Stand on up with me. Praise God. You say, well, Pastor, that was fast. Yeah, I got you through today. I want to get you out of here. Well, bless God. God has something for you this morning. Amen? He has something right here for you this morning. And for you on Facebook, he has something at home for you right now. If you have been just kind of wishy-washy, distracted by the world, you know, and it's easy. I ain't going to lie to you. It's easy to get caught up in all the politics and the hoopla going on and to be bogged down with this stuff here, where you can find yourself frustrated sometimes. Unnecessarily. Unnecessarily so. You know, let me tell you something. If you're frustrated with your president, you're focused too much on the world. Do you hear what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Listen, church. Christians should not be focused on Donald Trump or Joe Biden. We ought to be focused on Jesus. I'm telling you the truth this morning. I'm telling you the truth. Why the Holy Spirit spoke to me, we got to get it right.
Amen.
Our hope ain't coming from the White House.
Amen.
Our help doesn't come from there. So why do we worry ourselves with this? Fix your heart on Jesus this morning. Get your eyes back on the Savior. He loves us. Gave everything for us. Standing there waiting for us right now. Won't you come home? Father God, I thank you this morning. I thank you that you love us. And I thank you, Lord, that you care enough about us to just not even just wipe us out, Lord, but you're gracious with us, patient with us. Long-suffering, the scriptures say. God, in your patience, Lord, you've overlooked many things we've done, many mistakes, many sins, Lord God. We're not going to water it down. It's sin. You've overlooked sin this morning, Lord. You've kept us, Lord, by your grace and by your mercies, Lord, and by your mighty hand, Lord. And only by your grace, only by you, Lord, are we still standing this morning. So we look up this morning. We call out to you this morning. We say, Father, thank you this morning, first of all. Thank you for saving us. Thank you for salvation this morning. Thank you for the blood of Jesus this morning. Thank you for the gift of grace this morning. Thank you for the power of the Holy Spirit right now that is breaking through in the hearts and the minds of your people today, God. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Now, Lord, we open up the heavens to see you. As we praise you, Lord. Lord, we ask you to pour on us. We need a fresh outpouring, a fresh infilling, a fresh filling of the Holy Spirit this morning. Empower us, God. God, take out the double vision. Remove the double heart. Take out the distractions, God. And help us to fix our eyes squarely on you. Oh, God, we praise you this morning. Thank you for your grace, for your love, and your mercies.
Yeah.
Now, God, bless your people, I pray, as they go out this week.
Yeah.
Keep each one as the apple of your eye. Cover their homes with favor and their footsteps with grace. Bless their hands to prosper in all things, I pray. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, I bless each of you. Let's go have a great week in Jesus Christ. God bless you. Yeah.